So I tried to 20th century mathematics, and that was my first talk of popular mathematics. And I think it was very, very, very enjoyable. Maybe not for the audience, but I really enjoyed it. And that's why I decided to go up to the second episode, More Hiking in Modern Math World. The formula will be very similar. So if you haven't seen the first talk, it's on YouTube. And the formula today is going to be very similar. We're going to be exploring some metaphorical landscape. So today's metaphorical landscape is the Rinjani volcano in Indonesia, just because I like to brag about my holidays. Yeah, I was there. It was awesome. So today we're going to have a lot of ground to cover. We're going to have all these viewpoints we'll be stopping at, and these are all just spectacular, and I hope I'll be able to show you, to give you a glance at just how amazing these all are. So without further ado, let's start with the first destination, the theory of computation. And I'm going to illustrate that with this example. It's called the traveling salesman problem. I guess in our case, it's more like the traveler problem. So imagine you wanted to go for a trip around the world, but you don't really know where to go, so you ask your friends, and your friends give you a list of places you have to go to, which are the squares and the circles in this map. So you have this list of places you have to go to, but what you really want, if you want to book your flight ticket, for instance, is rather the itinerary you're going to take. And particularly, you're going to be interested in the cheapest itinerary that goes through all these places. Now, that's the traveling salesman problem. You have a bunch of points in space, and you're searching for the cheapest itinerary that goes through all these points. Now, we're not actually interested in the particular solution to this problem. What we're rather really interested in is the method to solve this problem. Because if you only know the solution and you meet somebody else, say me, who tells you that actually don't go waste your time here in Russia, where you really should go to is Indonesia, especially to the Rinjani volcano, you're going to have to solve your problem again. And if you don't know how, well, it's like the Japanese saying goes, give a man a fish and you feed him for a day, teach a man to fish and you feed him for a lifetime. And that's the idea of the theory of computation. Now, our job as mathematicians is not really to apply the method. It's rather to invent, to create new methods. And that's a very important point, because a lot of people out there think that mathematics is mainly about doing long calculations or difficult computations or playing very difficult method. But that's not mathematics. Well, you can understand why they would think that. I mean, all along along the education and even undergrad, what people are taught to do in high school, in all math courses, is always to apply methods. But applying methods is a job for dummies. It's lame. I don't mean that it's easy. It can be very difficult to apply a method. But it's just not mathematics. And something that mathematicians have known for a while now. In fact, in the beginning of the 20th century, mathematicians have outsourced the job of computation. They would give it to somebody else and they would focus on the mathematics. Now, this other person who does the computation, he was called a computer. That's what a computer was back then. Now, it was still a qualified job. You still needed to know about the mathematics to do computations. But then came Alan Turing. Alan Turing is a British mathematician, one of the greatest of the 20th century. And Alan Turing is the man who proved that computing was a job for dummies. He showed that you didn't need to think to do computations. How did he prove it? Well, he showed that any computation could be done by a machine. And not necessarily a complicated machine, even the simplest machine could do computations. He even proved a much more important theorem, which is probably one of the most important theorems of the whole of mathematics. He proved that you only needed one machine. If you built one machine and you build it well, like for instance this machine, you could do all computations. And that's a key idea. It means that we can separate the job of creating the machine and the job of thinking about the methods. We can separate the hardware from the software. And this is a key idea that has been driving new technologies. Now, Alan Turing was more interested in the theoretical question than in the applied question. In particular, he was wondering if this very powerful machine, and yet very simple, it's a mechanical machine, he wondered if this simple machine could be solving our problems. Now, who thinks that it can? Who thinks that it can't? Okay, so who has no opinion? Well, the answer is that it can't. There are problems which are undecidable, which means that there's no machine that always solves them. There's no systematic way of solving them. Unfortunately or fortunately, in the core of mathematics, there's a problem that's undecidable. It's the problem of finding proofs to a theorem. There's no way, systematic way to find a proof to a theorem. Now, this leads me to talk about another